I would like to take, I would like to express my sincere appreciation for the honor bestowed on me to be the chairman for this memorable event. I will take this opportunity to congratulate the event organizers for the wonderful work done to organize this maiden award. I will also congratulate all the members of the Central Regional Chapter of Ghana Journalists Association, especially the award winners, for their immense contribution towards the development of Central Region through professional journalism. Central Region, as we are aware, has been branded as one of the poorest regions in Ghana for many years. This is a wrong perception that needs to be changed. Central Region is endowed by nature with many investment opportunities, such as a long coastline for fishing, salt mining, tourism, etc. The region is also blessed with the fertile land that supports a cultivation of cocoa, oil palm, coconuts, citrus, pineapple, pepper, rice, tomatoes, just to mention a few. I will call on all media personnel and their various media houses to market the region to investors, both local and international, to take advantage of the natural endowment and invest in the region. I will also take the opportunity to advise the youth to go into farming, and I can assure them that in a few years to come, they will be counted among the rich men in Ghana, if not in Africa. I will advise the reporters to show professionalism, to be circumspect in their reportage, to maintain sanity and dignity in their field of work. False news put out themselves and spread faster and wider before it could be retracted. The image of the affected person is well beyond specification. Ladies and gentlemen, I will advise you to always cross-check your stories by reaching the affected persons to get their side of the issue before it goes into public consumption. This practice will help to install dignity and sanity in the media. Anything contrary to this will abuse the freedom of speech we are enjoying in the country at the moment. On this note, I accept to chair a remarkable occasion like this. Let all of you support me on this occasion. Thank you very much. May God bless us all. Thank you.
This award ceremony has been instituted to recognize practicing journalists and media practitioners in the Central Region who made immense contribution to the growth of the region and beyond. The event is being organized for the first time in the region, and it's not only to celebrate the achievements of journalists, but also to encourage media practitioners that when their work is well executed, they will be rewarded. State of the region. Ghana has already taken a sail out of my way, but I'll mention it. You will agree with me that there's a vast, untapped, pristine, and rich resources deposited across the region, which, when fully harnessed, could ignite and make our region alive to become one of the best in the country. Regrettably, our region, which is a gold mine in inverted commas, has been negatively tagged And this has unfortunately sunk deep into the souls of its people. I must admit that there are challenges in this region, even though numerous, the situation is not hopeless. Manager, it is for this reason that the theme for this maiden ceremony, the economic transformation of the central region, media stake in attracting investors, was carefully chosen to garner the support of all media practitioners to focus on stories that will impact positively on the lives of the people and foster the growth of the region. The DJ activities in the central region. DJ Central has faced numerous challenges, especially organizing this program. It hasn't been easy, but it could not deter us from holding this maiden awards and as we further strive to chalk significant successes. Membership. Last year, we embarked on a rigorous membership drive to scale up our numerical strength. I will at this point entreat all practicing journalists, media personnel who have requisite qualifications to register, for them to enjoy the privileges of the association, some of which are training and moral support. Also, in our bid to broaden our scope, the branch is hoping to open a chapter for students of communication studies at the University of Cape Coast, UCC, to help attract the cream like the cream among them into our fold. Training. Madam Chairman, as my journalism lecturer said, Professor Bani, he said, journalism is a dangerous tool in the hands of the untrained. I repeat, journalism is a dangerous tool in the hands of the untrained. Why did he say so? When untrained, people do their own thing with their microphone, with their pens, and you know the pen is mightier than the sword. And so this bullet statement should be food for thought for everyone, because the media terrain has become murky, fraught with many untrained people who are busily butchering the profession. It is against this backdrop that the branch is planning to organize a series of seminars and training for members to upgrade their journalistic skills and task them to uphold high ethical values and professionalism. And actually, just 2 weeks ago, 10 of our journalists were in Goa on a GGA UNICEF training workshop on ethical reporting on children. Again, our sister Sally Ngeze of PCFM was sent to China for a 3-week program, courtesy our mother organization. She returned just last night and she's amongst us as I speak. I thought I'll get an applause for her. Next month, the International Federation of Journalists is also partnering us to sponsor, to train 20 female journalists. So that one too is in the pipeline. Ladies journalists here, get ready for it. It is necessary that we build strong synergies to make greater positive impact and significantly remain relevant in our chosen profession to impact society positively. Projects. Plans are underway for DJA Central to build its own ultra-modern office and press center where members can carry out research, work on their stories, and hold meetings in a relaxed environment. It is for this reason that we are going to hold an appeal for funds, and we hold and treat everybody here to support us to achieve that goal. Awards. Tonight, six retired veteran journalists who distinguished themselves during their time and are still working behind the scenes to sanitize the profession will be recognized. May I take this opportunity to pay glowing tribute to our seniors who worked tirelessly but never had the opportunity to be recognized during their time. A big aipo to all the awardees and to all hardworking journalists whose interest is not their stomach, but the plight of the voiceless and the vulnerable. At this juncture, I would like to thank our sponsors. Papa Abakateksin, we are very grateful. Sontek, we also want to say thank you to the Regional Coordinating Council.
Mr. James Dawson Anan is our first awardee this evening. He's our first awardee this evening. That's right. Come on, put your hands together for the young man. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Oh, come on, put your hands together for him. Put your hands together for him. Thank you,
Mr. Anan. Namaskar. Thank you.
Shall we receive Mr. Paul Ajete Jane? He retired from TV3. Okay, quickly. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Paul Ajete Jane, this way, move here and let us get started. His initials is PAD. I haven't mentioned anything. Paul Ajete Jane. And you have not laid a hand on that book, look for it. Twitching the Tiger's Tail. You would understand how they wrote stories in the 70s and the 80s. You read a book and it's like you are watching television. Put your hands together for him once again. Wonderful man by all standards. Thank you, God bless you. And then there is another young man, Mr. George Ebosaki. Are you here? Mr. George Ebosaki. Mr. George Ebosaki. Let me move on to Mr. Joe Autry. Is he here? Graphic. Mr. Joe Autry. Mr. Joe Autry. Thank you. So, Mr. George Reed retired from GDC. Hey, sorry, Daily Graphic, from Van Chem. GDC and Daily Graphic, I'm going to send that for. Hey, I'm going to send that one. But, all right, so thank you very much. Mr. Dexter, we thank you very much for the honors. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. But remember, Fireband is here. So, the honorary awardees are going to also teach us how they used to rock and roll in those days. Put on your dancing shoes.
Maybe being tributes, but they are here. And if I tell you what we're going through, you wouldn't believe it. Fellow media practitioners, ladies and gentlemen, good evening once again. And let me also, on behalf of the committee, welcome you to this award night and the celebration of excellence of the candidate and winners of the BEDIN GGA Central Regional Award Ceremony. As you may be aware, this evening the GGA is going to present award to outstanding stories that you presented for vetting and scoring. I'm glad to say that it has been an honor to be the chair for the vetting committee. I honestly enjoy listening, watching, reading through your wonderful stories. And I know my committee members equally enjoy working on your scripts. So on behalf of the vetting committee, I'd like to express my gratitude to the executive of the Central Region branch of the Ghana Journalists Association for the confidence that was reposed in us to develop the entries for this year's award. This evening event is an occasion for all of us to reflect on the important role of the media, the diverse and independent media in aiding democracy. Obviously, cannot be overemphasized. Without freedom of expression and free media, an informed, active, and engaged citizenry is impossible. It is crucial to make sure that critical voices can be heard and that journalists can perform their work independently and without undue interference from any quarters. Ensuring that the full spectrum of views, interests, and concerns are presented fully in the media is central to any inclusive democracy. And I'm sure all of us gathered here will agree with me that the theme for the day, the economic transformation of Central Region, media stake in attracting investors is very apt and appropriate. To have this goal realized, Nana Chair, journalists must display the following six core duties in my view. Duty to self, duty to the audience, duty to the employer, the organization, he or she might be working for, duty to professional colleagues, duty to society, and above all, the one I love most, duty to set appropriate agenda and make sure this is carried through. Madam Chair, the vetting committee was tasked to vet, scrutinize, content, and select the best scripts or audio visuals for the awards based on an agreed journalistic criteria and guidelines as provided by the GJA. We are happy to say that this is very encouraging to receive 48 entries. All the 48 entries submitted portray very good journalistic skills and unique angles to tell captivating stories of individuals. All entries were independently vetted and scored using the scope of criteria given by the GGA, after which the scores were computed and ranked. And trust me, it was a tough competition. I am so impressed. To prevent any possible biases, the final evaluation or assessment was done by an independent professional external assessor to make sure that we were on the right path. The external assessor looked at both the category 1 and 2. On the category 3, a special questionnaire was designed and administered to 14 regional stakeholders to select their best radio station in a region, saying there was no entries for the radio station category by the stations themselves. The responses from these critical stakeholders in the region were analyzed, and then we could come out with a winner. Guided by a unique marketing scheme, the vetting committee members worked independently and later collectively to tally the results to produce the various winners. The work was very thorough. The competition was very keenly contested. The committee, among other issues, realize that most of you journalists did very well with your entries. And Nana, we haven't lost it as a region. We still have very good upcoming journalists, very professional ones. Congratulations to all of you. However, the committee, among other issues, observed that some entries could not meet the journalistic standard. I must say that there is room for improvement for some of our upcoming journalists. The passion is there, but I think we need to train and train more, notwithstanding the above. And being the main award, the output from the intern were largely good and commendable. We have few recommendations for GJA Central. We believe, and I'm happy the chairperson mentioned that in passing, GJA should organize relevant, continuous professional development workshops and seminars for its members, and of course, media practitioners to improve their professional practice and performance. Two, there should be a recategorization of the awards to make it clear and also to cover other key areas of the journalism practice. Because for us, we realize the key area like sports, entertainment, governance, and leadership issues were not covered by the categorization. This is a humble appeal. The third point, it comes to you, my colleague journalists. Journalists, media practitioners should be strategic. Your this is a competition. You should be strategic next time in filing your awards. Why are we saying, for example, good stories which otherwise could win awards were placed in a very competitive, oversubscribed category. And that we thought too bad. First, second, third, fourth, fifth. All good stories, but placed in one category. You know why? It's like you need to pick one. It's like trying to go to St. Augustine's at the side of France Ben at the same time. Who will pick you as the first choice? If you don't get your first choice, the second choice, by the time you get there, they are already full. So we think it should be strategic. In conclusion, Nana Chere, we take this opportunity to thank the GJA for selecting us to do this noble but difficult job. More so, the confidence reposed in us. We are grateful, very grateful. We also use this opportunity to congratulate the GJA itself, because it's not easy to come out with this awards cake. And the journalists and the media practitioners who participated in this maiden and historic competition, whether you win or not for us, you've done well. My committee worked hard with integrity. We pray to be more excellent when given the opportunity again. Thank you once again for giving us this noble work. It has been a privilege to serve. Long live GJA, long live professional media practice. Thank you very much.
What is this?
Beautiful. Beautiful. Thank you. Thank you, Nana. God bless you. So take Nana to her seat. The young lady. Okay. Thank you. Your commander is here, right?
General from Cape Coast. Now, it follows him through to Kumasi in the Asante region to Sefi in the Western region, and catalogues the humiliating situations he has to go through on a daily basis because of his disability. Now he's taking this award for News Reporting Electronic. Let's welcome Spencer Mensa. He is with TV3.
Thank you.
With his story captioned, A Journey to the West, Episode 1 and 2. Thank you very much, Spencer. Our second award, the competitive one, is for news reporting print. Now, the pomp and pageantry that characterized the commissioning of the Comeda Sugar Factory brought a lot of expectation and hope to residents of Comeda, and indeed people within its environs. But today, the sugar factory is a white elephant, one that has captured the attention of a lot of journalists within the region, and even those who are not within the region. So this award goes for a story caption, government urged to get Comeda Sugar Factory working. And here's the brief. The report follows a research carried out by the College of Agriculture and Natural Sciences of University of Cape Coast on the topic Spatial Assessment of Sustainable Feedstock Supply to the Comeda Sugar Factory. The research was to quantify the actual and potential feedstock supply capacity of the factory. Out of the research, a recommendation was made to government to move swiftly to get the factory working to keep the enthusiasm and the general willingness among farmers and people within the catchment area of the Comeda Sugar Factory alive. Shall we welcome Afizi Abdullah of GFA Ghana News Agency? He takes the award for news reporting prints.
As my face are faded by the sun, the thoughts of men stand by the hill. The thoughts like this are fierce to still. The thoughts of men cry over the hill. The fall is blind, the weak is bound, the warrior fights, the battle of fall. The scavenger is weak, man is weak, death is weak.
Right, thank you very much, Honorable Central Regional Minister, Mr. Kwame Dankwa. Let's do it for him as he takes his seat. And let me kindly march of awards. Let's welcome him. And then this story looks at job creation, what comes first. He says, Ghana loses between 20 and 50% of all vegetables, fruits, cereals, roots and tubers produced each year while it struggles to achieve food security and eradicate hunger. The feature centers on job creation and whether factories must be built first or the raw materials be produced first. Let's welcome Efo Timothy Koku Goba of Rafi. The Efo had to come, and I know I'll be in trouble, that's fine. I understand I have reduced his rank. He's now talking Timothy Koku Goba. He comes for this award. Let's do it for in place, and as this gathering seeks to award people whose stories have impacted society so well, the next award is for environment and sanitation, and this story chronicles the life of a drug addict. There is a looming crisis over drug abuse in Ghana, and this story follows the life of a 56-year-old drug addict after losing his parents at a tender age. Let's welcome Adjoa Adobia Owusu of TV3 as she picks this award. Let's do it for Adjoa. After hearing the song for Adjoa, teenagers are left unattended for weeks. It goes under the environment and sanitation category. Now, predicting the possible outbreak of cholera, malaria, and other filth-related diseases that are bound to befall the residents of Asinfosu and its neighbors, the news article focused on the state of unattended Zone Lion containers filled with filth and a breeding place for mosquitoes left alone by the waste management company. Let's welcome Nana Benin Jojo Elisa as she takes the award. Nana Benin.
I bring you greetings from the National Executive. The President, Afel Moni, would have loved to be here. In fact, all was set for him to come. But unfortunately, he was taken ill last night and he couldn't make it today. But thank God, on my way here, communicating with him is getting better. So on this note, the National Executive will want to congratulate our dear sister, Alice Sete, and her able team for putting together this extraordinary first ever regional award. In fact, it goes into the history books of the Ghana Journalists Association. It has never happened before in the central region, isn't it? So it is possible under the able leadership of our chairperson, our dear sister, Alice Tete, and her able team, Shelley. And then, where is the secretary? I equal to you. In fact, it's not easy putting up something like this. I can imagine what they've gone through to come to this stage. And I really admire the decor, the certain arrangements, and how lovely you all look. Again, this is just to recognize the hard working of some journalists who have distinguished themselves throughout the year. And it is also to encourage and motivate all of you to also put up your best in the region. In fact, it has become a policy for GJA to decentralize the GJA awards. From henceforth, it's not going to be only at the national level, but the regional level. Every region is organizing something like this. So now it is a policy. I thought we were going to clap for that. The GJA again has rolled out a lot of activities, and as you all know, this year marks our 70th anniversary. And as part of the anniversary, we've rolled out a lot of activities. We have training programs, we have also getting to the end of the year, definitely will be entering 2020 and for elections. We've rolled out a lot of activities and I'll be sharing some of them with you as I stand here. So currently, moving on towards elections, We are partnering the National Peace Council and the UNDP to roll out training programs on elections, the role of the media, and definitely we'll be coming to the central region for each journalist in this region to have his or her share. We are also partnering the U.S. Embassy to also undertake similar training workshops on elections, and this will be for members, and it is also to position journalists in readiness for election reporting. And as we all know, the rates on politics is high, and political parties have started their primaries. So how best do we put them on their toes, monitoring the processes, and making sure that we have a peaceful election? We all know as journalists, we have a very key role to play. For us to have a peaceful election, much also depends on us. Again, we also have a project with Star Ghana, and as we all know, we'll be having referendum, we'll also be having the district assembly elections, and definitely Star Ghana project will be also training journalists to that effect. And as we all know, political parties, just recently as we witnessed in the Volta region, some journalists were beaten. And we are partnering the Ghana Police Service to ensure that journalists are secure, journalists have the safety in the discharge of their duties. And very soon we'll be moving to the regions, and central region is one of them. We are also embarking on a sanitation project, and that sanitation project was launched on the 10th of July this year at the press center, and we'll be having a regional activities as well. So we'll be coming to central region for a regional launch, and we are entreating all of you to be on board. We all know that sanitation has been an issue in Ghana, and GJA has taken it upon itself that as journalists, we have a key role to play. We have an advocacy role to play to make sure that people change their attitudes towards the environment. So that is what the sanitation project is geared towards. And in fact, as part of that, we are also going to embark on a cleanup exercise, and we believe that at the regional level, you also do so. Again, on our 70th anniversary, we've outlined some activities. We'll be having a series of lectures, one of which will be held in one of the regions, and that is yet to be decided on. And I pray that it will come here in the central region. So as part of the GJA 70th anniversary activities, aside the lectures that we've outlined, we are also going to embark on a blood donation exercise. We believe that it is not every day that we go a cup in hand begging for support from others. We believe that it is time for us to also give back to society, and that is what we'll be doing. We'll be donating blood to stop the National Blood Service to save lives. And then we are entreating the regional levels to also organize some programs. The national will support you in that effect. Again, for training programs, GJA is embarking on training programs, not only national, but then international as well. And it is going to be, every region will have a take in that. I'm told that some team went to China and they returned, I think this week or so, and a participant from Central Region was among the team that went to China for the training. We believe that the national cake, every region should have a share, and that is what we are going to do. So every region, just be rest assured, when the training is up, definitely somebody from the central region will be taking part. And it's not only national, but then we'll have international trainings as well. So pray that before the end of the year, we'll have as many reporters from the central region taking part in both national and international training as well. And we all know, without training, we cannot discharge our duties effectively. Journalism, we all know, is dynamic, and we need to always update our knowledge to that effect. On safety issues, is it a crime to practice journalism as a profession? I'm throwing this question to you and I need a response. Is it a crime to practice journalism? It is not. So why should journalists suffer the brutalities in the discharge of their duties? And that is what GJA is fighting for. So we are entreating every single reporter here. When going out on assignments, safety should be key. Safety should be the paramount. In fact, you need to leave to tell the story. Please, be on your guard and make sure that you take precautionary measures. And whenever you are attacked, kindly report to the regional executive, and whatever action or decision the regional level takes, the national will definitely be in support. We are also embarking on a training program on safety at the workplace for female journalists, and we are doing this in collaboration with the International Federation of Journalists. And very soon, in a few weeks to come, Central Region will be holding yours as well. So the female journalists here, how many are we? Oh, so sad. How many? I think I can't. Oh, you are many. In fact, we are going to take over the profession in Ghana. It is not a male-dominated profession anymore. As women, we have a role. And in fact, the men cannot do it without us. So women, take up the responsibility, take up the charges, and make sure you also rise to the top. On this occasion, I want, on behalf of the National Executive, also commend the sponsors of this program, and we say are you equal to all of you, and may God bless us all, and enjoy the rest of the program.
I want, on this occasion, to congratulate the regional branch and the EBO executive chaired by Mrs. Alice Tete and your lieutenants. I also want to congratulate all of you who are taking awards this evening, and especially our veterans for the good work, the foundation you laid and bringing the profession this far. I want to also bring it to the fore that this maiden edition is one that the executive must be commended for. I've had the opportunity to sit with them, and it was not easy. And so, Mrs. Tete and your executives, I highly commend you. But even more importantly, this is intended to spur you on, that if you do not take award this evening, it doesn't mean that you are not good. You are. And you must continue to strive. That I hope that when next year we meet here, those of you who are unable to take awards today, you will take awards when we meet next year. On the theme chosen, it is most appropriate. Your recognition that you have a major role to play in the development of the region. You have done quite well as far as I can recall as a minister, you either writing or on the console or television or whichever form of the profession, you have all sought to play your role to ensure that the interest of this region is served. I can only call on you that once you are so conscious of the development of the region and have decided even to take such a thing, then we must continue to strive to the point where this region indeed will come up and be able to exploit its full potentials. On this note, I wish to congratulate the regional branch of the association and to say that the future looks bright. And as long as we remain here, we will continue to collaborate with you and support you in all your future endeavors. Thank you.
Thank you. Of the last hour or so, and especially when I was finishing off my life song, the songs, cool and melodious, and in my days, those numbers we used to call the smoochies. Why am I carrying you get away from home? Fast service man. God bless you. Superior Court of the High Court in particular, let me acknowledge you. Man, can you hear ya? By court order, I'm not going to fiat. Now, fiat to run us with him, man, can you hear ya? I bet you man to move fiat. So let me also acknowledge the regional commander of the Ghana prison. So all other protocols duly observed. It is a singular privilege to have been invited to address you. Being mindful of the time, permit me to cut out a lot of what I would have said. But I will still say a few more things and assume my seat. I associate myself with the remarks of the chairman, also of the special guest of honor, the regional minister, also of the representative of the national president, and also of the remarks of the regional chair, that this is an auspicious occasion and we must congratulate all the worthy recipients of the various awards. It is on account of their hard work and labors. And for those others who didn't get awards, we know that you will work hard, and in the fullness of time, you will also get your awards. I am particularly privileged to have been selected to share some remarks with you on the theme. I will be speaking to 6 points very briefly. As I said, I will cut a lot of other things out. So I will be speaking to 6 points only. But I will precede the presentation of my 6 points by making some preliminary observations. And then I will talk about what we should expect if we are talking about economic transformation. The first observation that I wish to make is to recognize that for this special occasion, the various media houses that were present and to capture the event brought their mics ahead of time to the podium. It is a salutary development. In many instances, when speakers are speaking, That is when the various media houses bring mics and recorders. It is disrupting and disrespectful. And the proper media practice is for these accoutrements to be placed ahead of time at the venue. But I noticed that for the central regional edition, everything was in place at the right time. Central region, you have done well. But I gather the explanation is not on account of your fault, but because some other organization encumbered the event. I will also share the opinion expressed by the chairman when he said a lot of media practitioners tend to have one-sided reportage. I can indicate within the last year, for example, two such instances that I personally have encountered in the organization that I presently head. About 6 months or less than that ago, a newspaper in this country, quite well known, reported that one of the buildings of the Ghana Institute of Management and Public Administration was up for judicial sale because we had not honored certain financial obligations elsewhere. Totally false statement. And whoever fabricated this story and sent it to an otherwise reputable media house may have had his or her motives. But the media house did not bother to find out from the institution if it is true, and if so, how did it come about? Excuse me to say, irresponsible reportage. About 2 weeks ago, there was another report in another fairly well-known media house that the institute was planning to run a certain program at a certain campus. It didn't get to do it, and that it probably was doing certain things untoward. Again, the media house chose not to inquire whether it is true, and if so, what the explanation could be. It appears over the last 2 decades and counting, and it's getting worse by the year, various people will rush to media houses and various media houses will put stories out. And when they put their stories out, they probably will expect the other side now to come and tell their story. It is unfair and irresponsible, and I hope this practice will cease. I am aware of a certain lawyer who did not countenance such thing and has sued recently. It is not necessary to invite litigation or opprobrium to self, and I hope that as we are taking our affairs and our practice and our ethics seriously, and as the regional chapters are being strengthened, this dimension of proper journalism and its practice will be taken into account. I am also aware that sometimes media houses and the personnel they employ do not seem to be interested or have the capacity to follow what is going on. The side issues and the side bites, sound bites appear more interesting. So if someone is coming to give a presentation at an event, they will not listen, they will not understand. When they finish, they corner you. Then either they want your press statement or they want you to explain on the side. If the media is invited to an event or they recognize the importance of the event, I plead and pray you send people who have the capacity to appreciate what is going on, to report it comprehensively and fairly, to critique it and put the story out. But when some, not all, of the media people dispatched to cover events are not interested or qualified, it diminishes the media practice. Finally, as a preliminary observation, and this aspect has happened to me before, it appears that sometimes the stories that ought to be covered are not what the media appears to be interested in. There was one event that, for example, I was invited to participate in respect of a certain theme. We addressed the theme. When it was through and there was a reportage, they covered everything and they added words to the effect that in 2008, he was a contestant and lost the primaries miserably. What this has got to do with the story, as if to take away from the story, I do not know. If the idea is to address the issue, merit must be focused on and not diversionary issues to address it. I hope some of these comments will be taken in good faith, because as we improve upon our media practice for development of the nation, emphasis should be on professionalism, ethics, and merit. Professionalism, ethics, and merit. Mr. Chairman, the theme that I have been giving to address, which I will do so very briefly, is economic transformation of the central region, the media's stake in attracting investors. But what is economic transformation? And I will skip that. But what is the evidence that economic transformation has occurred? I suggest that evidence of economic transformation include that there is the availability of jobs for nearly everyone seeking a job. If there is a high state of joblessness, and anything in excess of 10%, I submit, should be extremely alarming. But if everybody suitably qualified and interested in finding a job can find a job, then we can say that there is economic transformation. Secondly, there ought to be increased income in our pockets. And with that income, we can take care of our households, we can meet basic needs, and perhaps we can afford a little luxury. Economic transformation is also evidenced in better public works, infrastructure, and services. What, Mr. Chairman, is the state of our roads? Electricity supply, water supply. What is the state of the health and educational services being rendered to us? So it is when we have these objective indicators of economic transformation that we can see to what extent the media should help us to achieve this. I suggest the media's role in this can be in at least five ways, perhaps six or more. One, we are in the last or approaching the end of quarter three and getting to the last quarter of 2019. Next year is election year. The fever of election year will require all effort to focus on that process. If the media is interested in the outcome for economic transformation, the media may wish to interrogate the incumbent regime, the alternative regimes, look at manifestos, ask about track records, verify track records, and educate the public appropriately. These exercises require, on the part of the media itself, the deployment of suitably qualified personnel and their capacity to undertake research themselves. But as we are approaching an election year, and where political power is intended to achieve economic transformation, the first thing that I will suggest for us, the media in particular, is to fashion out its role and not necessarily focus on newspaper review with tendentious positions and reporting sensationalism. The second thing, Mr. Chairman, more generally, is the propagation of the vision for development and values. The chair and the regional president, for example, indicated the various resources and potential of the region. How well are these sold to the citizenry, to the students, to national authorities and foreign investors to attract them to the region? It may be proper, I would suggest, that the media not only engage, for example, the regional minister who is present here, the regional coordinating council, the various planning officers in all the different local government units over here, National Board for Small Scale Industry and the like, and come out with blueprint as to how the central region should look in a year, 5 years, 10 years, 50 years, and 100 years. As the media itself tries to discover and uncover the plan and to propagate the plan, you will excite interest and you will excite the spirit of accountability. Prospects, therefore, have to be laid out. Success stories have to be shared. As people's success stories, small industries, medium-sized industries, large industries are shared, others will catch the fever and do likewise. Next, Mr. Chairman, I will talk about the sunshine role of the media. About 3 to 4 weeks ago, one very well-known media house, which is in all the forms, it has online outlets, it has radio outlets, it has television outlets, focused on the Lekma Hospital Road, some part in Accra. They were on it. They interviewed road minister, they interviewed the MP for the place, they interviewed the chief executive of the local government unit, they dealt with the citizenry. The road was very bad. It was not on account of initiative of the hospital or the Metropolitan Assembly or the minister responsible for roads.
that it was fixed. It was on account of the unrelenting attention and sunshine that the media placed. Then promises were made, and shortly after, the effort to fix it was done. Similarly, the roads, the danger on the roads, footbridges at the Adenta Madina area, and the state of some roads in Kumasi. If the media shines the light and is unrelenting, the necessary attention will be given. I am suggesting that if something similar is done in the central region in respect of the state of facilities at our schools, at our hospitals, at our roads, if our media houses pay a little, nay, a lot less attention on newspaper reviews, but on the conditions of the ordinary citizenry, shine the light and call to account, we will have far better schools and hospitals and roads and public services. May we repent of our ways. May we adopt improved ways, because it is with such that we will be able to make a difference. We also know the role of investigative journalists in the fortunes of this country. I'll just mention three who are fairly well, indeed very well known in this country. Very recently, the one who is making the headlines is Manasseh Azuri. We know of the various documentaries of Seth Kwame Boateng. We know of the work of Anas Arimiyao, Anas. We need the equivalent in significant measure in the region. As we have these, and we have the potentials, some have won awards today, but as we get these, working on the issues that touch our lives, and not on sensationalism or the like, we will help to make our place a better place. Finally, Mr. Chairman, permit me to also mention capacity development and training. I was happy to hear the representative of the national chair as well as the regional president speak about aspects of these. Perhaps monthly meetings at which training sessions will be held, or more frequent meetings if monthly is too soon, no less than quarterly. But monthly is what I will suggest, and these meetings will have a training session in different aspects of the practice. Some will end up in media practice, having come with training from journalism school. Some will pick it up on the job, and some are into it and don't pick anything up at all. It is not the entry features or characteristics that necessarily matter, but what does the association plan to put in place so that every media practitioner, however well trained you are, will improve upon your training. If you add to your agenda and to your remit monthly training, and I am able to suggest that with the resources of the Cape Coast Technical University, and more especially the bigger, more established University of Cape Coast available, you will be able to get resource persons with an academic flair to complement the practitioner flair. These universities will have people from communication studies, economics, development studies, engineering, law, and the like. And you can treat them as useful resource persons. Should some management or related public administration disciplines be called for? If you speak to the rector of the Ghana Institute of Management and Public Administration, he will be able to make such resources available. I suggest that we target all audience. It is a regional chapter, but it is not limited to regional resources. The regional chapter should be able to look to resources and audiences outside the region. It may very well be the outsider who will bring the idea or bring the money. So we should be looking to regional audiences and resources. We should be looking to national, and we should be looking to international. I am aware that many towns and cities in the region have twins abroad, in Europe, in North America, in Latin America, and the like. To what extent does the media engage with the twin towns and twin cities to see how economic transformation occurred there and how media practice is undertaken there? The twinning should not just be paper memorandum of understanding. The twinning arrangement must manifest in different ways. And as the Central Regional Branch of the GJA looks at this, I hope that in your various meetings, you will be looking at capacity development, you will be looking at investment support, and you will be looking at best practices from abroad and our twin societies. Finally, before I take my seat, particularly for the veterans amongst us, having congratulated you, put your life's experiences and thoughts into articles or, better still, books. It is from the experiences of the seasoned in the developed world that further development takes place. Retirement is an opportunity for reflection, giving back, and writing. And my challenge to the veterans is at the next edition of these awards, 1 year later, whilst other people are coming to receive the awards from and learn. I wish to take my seat and to congratulate you for this auspicious event. May the good Lord Himself add His blessings to all of you. Thank you and good evening.
The residents of Techikyom have been living in a state of agony for a long time, having to endure the brunt of dusty clouds and lack of portable water. Propelled this writer to let the world know about their plight. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome Togwe Timothy Koku Gobak as he picks this award for Kel. As he's coming up, I'll kindly call on Kelly Chief Justice Hannah Taylor to help us present the award. This award is going to Timothy Gobak for his story on agony of Techikyom residents. A story that tells the plight of the people of Techikyom, the brunt of dusty clouds and lack of portable water that they have to deal with. And that's the way you go back to picking the award.
All right, that's great, thank you.
It is said that a country that has not honored its kings, actually, maybe you stand up for us. It is said that a country that does not honor its heroes really would not go far, I guess. So this particular award
is honoring your story, caption honoring the memory of national heroes. Now this news feature honors the memories of two distinct leaders, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana and Mao Zedong of China. It highlights what the two leaders did for their respective countries and how each country treats their heroes. This award is under the category of tourism and culture. Help me welcome Spencer Mensah of TV3, who picks the second award for tonight. You can do it better for Spencer. Yes, and his colleague, Adewa Dubia, also is supporting him in this regard. Then comes Thomas Kahn, also TV3. Spencer is taking the award for tourism and culture with his story caption honoring the memory of national heroes.
So how much of this? You mentioned the winner, but then can you also thank you? You mentioned the winner, where they are, and that's the final award.
Right, thank you very much, my lady. Thank you, Spencer, and the crew from TV3. At this point, I'll call on Linda Santini to help us with our next set of presentations. And the title of the story is A Decade of Teaching in Akapani Classroom, the story of a rural teacher. I'll call on Alfred Amo. He's taking this story. Now, the brief says, defying all odds and prejudices associated with the posting of teachers in rural communities, the headmaster of Asin Edukrom Isuja NA Basic School, Orab Frank Apia, has for the past 10 years taught in a dilapidated Akakana school book to impart knowledge to the pupils of the community. Let's do it all. Alfred Amo, as he takes this award. This next award is going under
agriculture.
Now, as our backbone, and so this story focuses on cocoa farmers facing danger, strain disease attacks, fruiting trees, cocoa more likely to miss 1 million tons. That is the title of the story. I'll call on Nanabe Njojo Elisa. Now, Nanabe Njojo Elisa is picking this award under agriculture. Now, I'll give you a brief of the story. The story focuses on the desire of Ghana's cocoa industry to produce about 1 million tons of cocoa during the 2018-2019 mini crop season, but on the verge of collapse, and looked at the probable causes on why several acres of cocoa farms are being destroyed by strange diseases. Nanabe Jojo Inisa takes this award, and he writes for the Chronicle newspaper.
That's it. Should we call the MP?
Thank you very much, Nanabe. Still posted for the Congress. Thank you so much, Nanabe. And that's the second award we're speaking this year. Thank you very much, I'm really grateful. Let me now call on the Honourable Member of Parliament for Ogomoa East, Mr. Fudras Mbeni, to do us the honours as we present the next part. Let's hear it for him, please. Right, thank you
you very much, Samuel. Samuel Alfred Amo, he picked an award on small and micro squeezing officer, was arrested. Congratulations, Samuel. And he's supported by Abdul Abdullah, his Right, thank you very much, sir. I'll call on Mr. Sophia Mwa. Very well in promoted issues that impact growth and development. So I'll call on management of ATLFM, which is within the Campus Broadcasting Services Center of the University of Cape Coast, to pick this award. I'm a member of the station. I don't know if I'm going now. So I'll call on the manager. Come in, please. Okay, so Daniel Okoku, the program's coordinator, is here. So we connect you. We have Kognawo from the newsroom, Kojodai from the newsroom, Desmond is with programs, Alexander Hackman is with programs, and Mary Amabawa, host of the morning show. Let me join this one.
So this is not fair. Why do you live in here? That's so beautiful. Thank you. Thank you, ATLFM. Now I come and continue your job. You are not the recipients.
There is so much to say, and normally when you have so much to say, leaves you speechless. I, on behalf of my colleagues, for those who have been honored this evening, and for those who are working behind the scenes, ensuring that things happen in the region. We are deeply overwhelmed by this kind gesture that we have received this evening. You may be aware that the stories were done in 2018 when we were not expecting any honor, any award, because this is actually our job. But the light that you have shown on what we have done, we are extremely grateful. A number of demands, a number of issues have been spelled out this evening. We have been enlightened, we have been educated, and we have received insight on where to go to. We are grateful once again. We want to rather ask that there will be support. This is a region that there is so much here to be covered. And I wouldn't say that these stories are clandestine, they are quite open. Would ask that the owners of the media house institutions that we work for will give us all the enablement, both resources, money, human resources, time, so that we'll be able to live up to expectations. Once again, thank you and God richly bless you.